to volunteer to help do some periscoping.
Are you got it?
All right, Jake. What you're gonna do is click it in here. And you can adjust it or whatever.
Okay.
Make sure we can see it. Yes.
He's our new LSA president.
Alhamdulillah. Congratulations, brother.
Thank you.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam, Rasooli Kareem, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, bye-bye. First, alhamdulillah, I just want to really thank Allah for this opportunity. To thank Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for having been the phenomenal example to guide us to this way of life. I'd like to thank, alhamdulillah, my parents, both of whom are Howard University graduates. And actually I can share that I was actually conceived at Howard University. I know that because my parents graduation back then was in June, and I was born in August. And I would return 18 years to the day on August the 19th, 1974, I moved into SLO Hall. So for me, Howard University was like a very, 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 very special place. In this environment, alhamdulillah, to thank my teachers like Dr. Suleiman Yang, and I ask you please to make dua for him. He is sick currently, but alhamdulillah, as a guide, mentor, teacher over many, many decades, I can't thank Allah enough for Dr. Suleiman Yang. 1988-89, the academic year, we brought Imam Siraj Wahaj to teach a class every Thursday night in the undergraduate library lecture hall. If you know what that is, next to Founders, I don't know if they still call it that. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, right. Every Thursday night.
For a month?
For a year. We were college students. Back then, for $99, you could get a flight from New York to Washington. Round trip. And by the way, 1988, $99 was still a lot of money. It was students, alhamdulillah, who organized, big, scraped, we did whatever we could do so that we could bring Siraj Wahaj every week for a year. Only one thing we hadn't calculated on. And that is at 8 o'clock on Thursday night in 1988, the most popular television program in the history of television would be on the air. Cosby Show. We put Islam and Imam Siraj up against, at an HBCU, against the Cosby Show. Out of that, alhamdulillah, we thought we were going to get a lot of people to come to Islam and our community was going to grow. We didn't become wide. But all of the people who had that experience, we became deep. I'd like to thank my teacher, Sheikh Mohammed Al-Hanouti, Palestinian. He passed away just before Ramadan last year. But alhamdulillah, as an amazing, amazing teacher to really round out my understanding of Islam, I can't continue without telling you that to thank my teacher, Muhammad Majid, who we used to have a class in Carnegie Hall right here on campus every Sunday. It's hard to think you could have Imam Siraj every Thursday night and you could have Muhammad Majid every Sunday. And then, alhamdulillah, he became my teacher. And wallahi, I can't express to you enough the gratitude, what it means to really have real teachers and mentors and guides. I can't mention all of them, but they have a bumper sticker that says, if you can read this, thank your teacher. Well, alhamdulillah, well, I'm asking Allah to have mercy and peace on all of those teachers, that alhamdulillah, without them, I wouldn't be saying anything. There is a riwayah associated with the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam that says, the learned among you are the inheritors of the prophets. The learned among you are the inheritors of the prophets. That's a pretty tall place to be at. The Quran reminds us in the 39th surah, in the 9th ayah, say are those who have knowledge equal to those who do not have knowledge. That they're not equal. There's only people of understanding who will remember the lessons and the verses, the ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you have knowledge, alhamdulillah, it causes you to function differently. If you were to think about how Allah teaches and develops the human intellect in the Quran, Allah does it by repetition. So in the Quran, you'll hear a verse, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. What's it mean? I'm asking you.
Those who believe and work deeds of reconciliation.
One might say that amen is belief. My teacher, Sheikh Al-Hanouti, he said, Let's take amen to be a connection between us and Allah. A lot of people could say, oh, I believe, but they do something different. When you really have this connection with Allah, it causes you to have amal salihat. It's a consequence. It's not the same thing as the kind of thing like, okay, I know that H2O is water, right? That doesn't necessarily mean I'm going to drink it. But when you have the connection, it says, subhanAllah, I exist because of my relationship with that, then it causes me to function different. I give you probably the wildest example for me. I remember when I was in high school and they had a half day at school one day and my mother didn't know. So my friends in high school, they said, yo man, why don't we go over to so-and-so's house? You know what's gonna happen over there, right? You know what's gonna happen over there? Huh?
You're gonna
turn
up.
Huh? Yeah.
He said, it's like work.
But because of the human amana between me and my mother, I know that to keep that relationship, I'm not going to be able to have the amal, the actions with these people. It won't be amal salihat. It is that vertical and horizontal thing that I'm talking about with you today that creates the relationship between the student and the creation for social change. But if you're a student, the word scholar, anybody know the Latin words for scholar? It's Howard University.
But
you see within the Greco-Roman Latin thing, because we're using the word scholar, we think of scholarship and stuff like that, right? Anybody? No. I mean, it's good to know. The etymological root of the word scholar comes from the Latin scole, means one who lives at ease. It implies leisure time. And you may not think about your life and your work as a student as leisure time, but the reality is that you can't commit yourself to a life of study unless you have leisure time. Student sits back and reads day and night. They write, they analyze, they research. This is one of the challenges for those of us who come from less than wealthy backgrounds. It's difficult to be a scholar if you don't have free time. But alhamdulillah, we know the rich and intellectual legacy of Islam. The first words of the Quran revealed, Iqra, Bismi Rabbika Ladhi Khalaq. Read in the name of your Lord who created you from Alhamdulillah. My Sheikh said, don't translate that. It just is what it is. That drive impetus for us to become students, talib al-ilm, students of knowledge, that we might learn for the purpose of transforming our society. Students, alhamdulillah, who have been given this gift of having leisure time to sit back and read and to study in the university, have a great opportunity and a great responsibility. I want to digress for just a moment because I want to talk about maqasid al-sharia. What's Sharia? What's Sharia? You could say Islamic law, right? What else? Come on.
The path that leads to the water.
The etymological root would mean the path to the water. I'm not going to ask you how those two things go together, Shay. I'm just going to leave it. But whatever this state or order of things that Allah has ordained, we call it law. But our Sharia, to pray, to fast, to enjoin what is good, to forbid what is wrong, all of these things that are outlined in the Quran is what I'm talking about when I talk about Sharia. I'm not talking about cutting off people's hand and all of that stuff, right? That's for the video. Right, because we periscope. I want you to think about something that is on the foundation of that order that Allah has created, and that is maqasid al-sharia. What is that? Maqasid al-sharia. Don't look dumbfounded. Some of you are getting ready to graduate from university. What's maqasid al-sharia? You could guess. Maqasid al-sharia. Boom, bing, bing, boom, bing, bing. Boom, bing, boom, boom. Is that your final answer? The objectives of Sharia. I want to talk about this for a minute just to help put us a little bit in a kind of Islamic frame before I go black. Scholars of Islam have identified that within the science of the objectives of the law, that there are three main categories. And by the way, I'm periscoping, so you don't have to like take notes if you don't take, you're not like a note-taking person. One, needs, necessities, two, and desires. Within the objectives of Sharia, how does one acquire our needs, our necessities, and our desires? The thing called necessities is the thing I want to focus on right now. They call this in Arabic durura. There are five durura. Are you with me? And the reason that these five are important for us in the context of a historical black college or university, looking at institutions that